and welcome to this opinion leader workshop in non-small cell lung cancer. We're going to be focusing today on the application of emerging molecular strategies in non-small cell lung cancer. Over the last decade, we have moved from the era in which most patients with advanced non-small cell lung cancer who were treatment eligible received platinum-based doublets. We moved on to the understanding that histologic differences can impact therapeutic choice. And more recently, we've learned a great deal about the genetic and molecular characteristics of non-small cell lung cancer that are guiding our therapy in the future. Currently, almost 60% or more of adenocarcinomas have an identifiable molecular driver. And we know that even in squamous cell carcinoma, there is an expanding base of knowledge about the molecular characteristics and drivers in that disease. So we want to bring all this information to you. Although we don't have available novel agents for many of these targets as yet, there are many targets which are actionable with currently available or investigational agents. So we're going to review this emerging information for you and update you on diagnostic evaluation procedures, drug and target pairings that are appropriate, adverse events, and some ongoing clinical trials. And joining me today for this opinion leader roundtable in non-small cell lung cancer are our opinion leaders. To my left, Dr. Lecia Sequist from the Mass General Hospital and Harvard Medical School, and to Lecia's left, Dr. Alice Shaw, also from Mass General and Harvard, and to Lecia's left, Dr. Mark Kris from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center down the road in New York City. So we're going to begin with Lecia, and she is going to cover EGFR and some other targets usually associated with adenocarcinoma. Lecia?
Thanks, Jim. Thanks for tuning in today. We are going to quickly cover some topics about EGFR as well as MET and HSP90. So in general, what we're talking about with this session today is this promise of genotype-directed therapy, which has really in the last few years moved from a conceptual promise to a reality of how we practice in the clinic every day. This idea where you can take patients who used to be all treated the same, for example, adenocarcinoma of the lung, and really parse them out into different subgroups that should have different treatment algorithms right from the time of diagnosis. And with these cancers that have a driver mutation, where the whole biology of the tumor is set up to be exquisitely tuned into one signaling pathway, when you pair that with a drug that shuts off the signaling pathway, you get these dramatic responses. And this is mostly what we're going to be talking about today in terms of targeted therapy, or trying to achieve responses such as seen here. As Jim mentioned in the introduction, nowadays in testing of adenocarcinoma patients, 60% of patients have some type of driver abnormality identified, and here is the often seen pie chart from the LCMC experience with 733 patients. You can see that EGFR, which is what we'll talk about first, makes up about 20% of patients if you look at the sensitizing mutations, those that predict for good response to the TKI drugs. That's about 15% of the pie on this diagram. But also the green slice of the pie a little bit above that says EGFR other 6%. And that slice is mostly made up of exon 20 insertion mutation patients, which are not necessarily as sensitive to the EGFR TKI drugs, but may potentially be sensitive to other targeted therapies in the future. So when we think about finding a patient with a sensitizing EGFR mutation, such as deletion 19 or L858R, we have a very solid basis of evidence now to say that these patients should be treated with frontline EGFR TKI drugs. This table shows a sampling of 6 randomized trials. There are more than this, but these are the dominant studies that have led this change in the paradigm. Essentially, all of these studies are looking at EGFR mutant patients being treated with either a first-line EGFR TKI or platinum doublet chemotherapy. The TKI varies up and down the table from gefitinib, erlotinib, and afatinib, and the chemotherapy varies as well with either carbo and cisplatin or with a taxane, gemcitabine, or pemetrexed. But regardless of the combination that you use, the basic results that you see are quite similar, with response rates being 2 to 3 times higher when you use the treatment that's targeted toward the cancer biology, and also the median progression-free survival being several months, sometimes twice as long. So this is what guides our recommendation to start these patients with an EGFR TKI. We'll delve a little bit more deeply into two of the studies, the first one to be positive and the most recent one. So the very first one was the IPASS study, which the design is shown here. This study was not limited to EGFR mutation positive patients. It was a clinical selection. There were over 1,200 patients entered, and they were all clinically selected to be the type of patient who would do well with an EGFR TKI. The study was done in Asia, so all the patients were Asian. They all had adenocarcinoma. They were essentially all never smokers, and they were randomized to first-line gefitinib or carboplatin paclitaxel. The primary endpoint was progression-free survival. And if we look at the intention-to-treat curves, it doesn't look like a highly positive study. The KM curves actually cross, but if you look in the box in the upper right, you can see that the hazard ratio was quite positive, 0.74, with lots of zeros in the p-value. And it essentially not only showed that gefitinib was non-inferior, as the trial was set up to show, but it actually crossed the threshold for superiority. Why the Kaplan-Meier curves cross is because the study was actually comprised of two populations that acted in polar opposite directions. And the EGFR mutation positive patients, for the patients who had tissue available for assessment of their status, those that were positive for the EGFR mutation did even better with frontline gefitinib with a hazard ratio of 0.48. Whereas on the right-hand side of the slide, you can see that the patients who met all the clinical criteria, they were never smokers with adenocarcinoma, but they didn't have that genetic mutation. They were EGFR wild type. These patients did not do well with frontline gefitinib. This was a harmful strategy with a hazard ratio of 2.85. So this was really what set up the paradigm of you have to test. You can't guess what the mutation is based on clinical characteristics or anything else. You really need to know from the tumor what is the matching treatment. So this was the IPASS study, and all the others have followed afterwards. The most recent study that led to the FDA approval of afatinib is the LuxLung-3 trial. So this is the first one to be done with a second-generation EGFR drug, afatinib. Afatinib differs from erlotinib and gefitinib in that it has a broader spectrum. It doesn't just hit EGFR, but it also hits HER2, and it's also an irreversible binder. So instead of being able to be competed off of the EGFR inhibitor by ATP, it actually forms a covalent bond and sticks directly to it. So in this study, which was an international study, patients were randomized. They had to have an EGFR mutation to enter, and they were randomized 1-to-1 to frontline afatinib versus cisplatin pemetrexed. This is also the first study to compare with pemetrexed, which over time has evolved to be the favorite chemotherapy drug for adenocarcinoma patients. And here are some demographics. Mainly the thing that I wanted to point out on this slide is the bottom row that shows the type of EGFR mutation. The majority of the patients in this study did have the two most common and most activating mutations, deletion 19 and L858R, but you can see that there are about 10% of patients across the study that had other mutations, including exon 20 insertion mutations. And for that reason, there were pre-specified analyses to look at everyone and then the patients with the more common mutations. So when we look at the primary outcome PFS in all the patients, we see that the median PFS for afatinib is 11.1 months and 6.9 months for the chemo, statistically significant finding. Perhaps more relevant to the majority of patients is looking at that 90% of patients that had the most common mutations, L858R and deletion 19. Here, the median PFS is 13.6 months, and for chemotherapy is the same, 6.9 months. So this is actually the FDA indication for afatinib. It's these most common activating mutations. One thing that gets discussed a lot in practice, now that we have two drugs available for frontline use in the United States at least, for EGFR mutant patients, you've got erlotinib and you've got afatinib, how do you choose between the two? The bottom line is we don't have a study yet comparing them, so we don't have, you know, we don't have a real evidence basis to say we can choose one or the other. There are some differences. In my opinion, the differences are mild in either direction. What's talked about is that there may be a little bit longer survival advantage for the afatinib. You can see the PFS, it was 13 months in a similar study with erlotinib. It's been 9 months, but there have been other studies with erlotinib where it's been longer than that. So it's hard to know until we have a direct head-to-head comparison. It's also talked about the adverse events, and this is a summary slide of, at least from the LuxLung 3 study, what we've seen with adverse events. I think, in my experience, the second generation drugs do have a little bit more diarrhea and rash. They just need more upfront and proactive management. It's not significantly more rash, in my opinion. But this is the, there were actually 96% of patients on afatinib reported any evidence of diarrhea, 15% had grade 3. And as far as rash, it was 16% with grade 3 rash from LuxLung 3. To address this concern about rash and diarrhea, actually, Dr. Yang did an analysis at ESMO last year combining LuxLung 3 and another similar study done in Asia, same kind of design, frontline afatinib and EGFR mutants compared to chemo. And he looked at the two halves of the study where patients were randomized to afatinib and looked at the episodes of rash and diarrhea that they had. And the biggest chunk of both of these pies is the dark blue piece, which is patients who only had one episode of rash or diarrhea. So, but they're definitely are a little bit different in terms of the management. And one of the things that I recommend for patients being treated with afatinib is that they start on prophylactic antibiotics to help minimize the rash and other skin side effects when they start on the drug. Diarrhea can be managed similar with erlotinib, which is that if it happens, you can take Imodium to control it. So in summary, this is where we stand with frontline EGFR therapies. Big difference from several years ago where we weren't sure if these treatments that were directed toward the tumor biology would ultimately affect patient outcome. Now we have several randomized trials showing that they improve PFS. Many of these trials also included a quality of life analysis that universally favored the TKI. And we're still waiting for mature survival analyses on some of these trials. Some of them have showed no difference in survival, probably because of patients that were randomized to chemotherapy ended up at some point in their life getting the TKI, to which they were still very sensitive. Now, what do we do when patients do become resistant? After somewhere between 1 to 2 years, the vast majority of these patients develop acquired resistance. And what we know from both basic science research as well as from doing biopsies on patients is that in general with these targeted therapies, there are two main types of resistance. You can have an alteration of the target itself, like EGFR being altered with a T790 mutation, or you can have a bypass track that develops. In EGFR lung cancer, some of the bypass tracks that have been described for resistance to erlotinib, for example, are MET amplification, PI3K mutations, HER2 amplification, BRAF mutations. There are lots of different things. In fact, here is one pie chart from our repeat biopsy at Mass General. Others, such as Memorial, have also published their repeat biopsy experiences, which have been generally similar. T790M is the big player in the room when we're talking about acquired resistance for EGFR patients. We do see some more rare things, for example, small cell lung cancer transformation and EMT changes, but the by far and away the most common thing that's seen is T790M. So how do we treat T790M? Well, one of the first, before we even get to this slide, I'll back up and say that we thought the second generation drugs, like afatinib, or the first one to come out was actually called neratinib, we thought these were going to be the be-all and end-all of treating T790M. Unfortunately, second-generation drugs, when used by themselves, have not proved to be very effective for treating acquired resistance to the first-generation EGFR drugs. But we did see from this work that came out of William Powell's lab that using afatinib in combination with the EGFR antibody cetuximab could be effective, and not only for T790 positive, but also for T790M negative patients. We've seen about somewhere between a 30 and 40% response rate to this combination treatment, and some patients having quite a durable benefit. This treatment does have some significant skin toxicities. Again, with proper prospective and preventive management, most patients can get through it. I think what we'll see over the next year is more data coming out about these so-called third-generation EGFR TKIs. These are different from the prior drugs. They have a higher relative affinity for T790M. They are irreversibly binding like the second-generation drugs, but really the big difference that distinguishes these newer drugs, all still in phase one clinical trials, from the older EGFR TKIs is this idea that they don't hit the wild type EGFR. So you actually don't get rash or diarrhea with these drugs. You're able to dose them to a much higher relative dose, and we have seen activity with several of the different compounds in patients who have acquired resistance, and emerging results will be presented at scientific meetings later this year. So when you have a patient who's progressing, one of the main things to do is think about whether you can get them on a clinical trial. But if that's not something that's available and you're thinking about how to treat them in the community, in your clinic, one of the main things you need to be aware of is this concept of disease flare when you discontinue the EGFR TKI. This is now really an established phenomenon in EGFR mutants. It has been seen in other types of oncogene-driven cancers as well. But up to 25% of patients, and I actually think that that may be an underestimation. Patients who are already starting to progress on their radiographs, if you take them off of the EGFR TKI, they can have much more progression. It's things that lead them to be hospitalized or even fatal progressions can happen in as little as a few days. The median time in this series reported from Memorial was 8 days from the time of drug discontinuation to the peak of the flare. So this is real, and I usually think of it as this diagram of the iceberg, that what you see progressing on the CAT scans is actually just the tip of the iceberg, the most resistant cells. But there are a lot more cells under the surface, some of which are still quite sensitive to the drug you're giving every day. If you stop giving that drug, you've got a whole bunch more tumor cells that are going to start growing compared to before. So continuing beyond progression has become a main tenet of taking care of these patients. And one thing that is often done in practice, although admittedly with little data behind it yet, is this idea of adding chemotherapy to the ongoing continuing TKI. And here's an example picture of a patient of mine who, at the time of diagnosis, had a relatively large left upper lobe cancer, had a great response as expected to first-line erlotinib in this case, but then became resistant, and at that point we added chemotherapy in, and she had another great response. Some retrospective analyses have shown that this phenomena is true, that adding chemo to a TKI may be better than switching completely to a chemo and omitting the TKI, but we're waiting for prospective studies. And Leora Horn is running a prospective study in the U.S. and Tony Mock in Asia to try and validate this hunch. So that's all we have time for as far as EGFR today. I'm going to quickly touch on MET and HSP90. So MET is another signaler that's important in cancer. One of the, I would say in lung cancer, the two areas where MET is most thought of is one with acquired resistance to EGFR in EGFR mutants, and two, it can be its own separate driver mutation where MET amplification can be the predominant signaler within a cancer cell. So far, with some of the MET inhibitors, the largest studies to have been done have not been in a genotype-selected population. They've been in combination with erlotinib as a second-line treatment for all comers with lung cancer. We have a study that's been done with tivantinib, an oral small molecule, as well as the MetMab monoclonal antibody, both in the second line setting combined with erlotinib. But there is, as I'll show you, evidence of single agent activity when you pick the correct patient, and I think some of the newer studies to be done over the next several years will look specifically at the EGFR mutant patient with acquired resistance. So the marquee study is the randomized trial that looked at tivantinib. This was a follow-up to a phase 2 study which showed potential activity with the combination tivantinib and erlotinib compared to erlotinib alone. So a larger definitive study was done. Essentially, these are patients who had 1 to 2 prior systemic regimens for their non-small cell lung cancer. And no prior EGFR TKI exposure. They were randomized to tivantinib and erlotinib or placebo and erlotinib. And the bottom line of the study is that it was a negative study. There was no difference in overall survival seen with this combination. Now, the MetMab monoclonal antibody is a totally different drug. It's a monoclonal antibody against c-MET. But again, there was similarly promising, perhaps more promising, phase 2 results looking at erlotinib and MetMab. And they used as a biomarker in this phase 2 study an IHC test for MET. And among the patients who were MET diagnostic positive, there was, as you can see on the left-hand side of the slide, there was a substantial benefit for the onartuzumab or the MetMab antibody with erlotinib. In the patients whose tumors were negative for MET IHC, there was actually harm compared to the placebo. So that was interesting. So they followed this up with a prospective trial looking at only the MET diagnostic positive patients, and we'll be seeing the results of that study soon, although recently there was a press result that was a little discouraging about the results, but we haven't seen the full results of this study yet. Now, this is a patient of mine who was treated off protocol with MET amplification as their driver mutation, and we treated this patient with crizotinib because, in addition to being an ALK inhibitor, crizotinib is actually a very good MET inhibitor, and this patient had a great response that lasted for almost 2 years. If you can identify the 1% of the patients out there that have MET amplification, crizotinib is a great option, and other MET inhibitors maybe as well. And this is another anecdotal report of a patient of mine with an EGFR mutation who, when they developed resistance to erlotinib, it came via MET amplification. And you can see the FISH images on the lower left show that compared to the baseline where there was no MET amplification, MET amplification developed, and this patient went on a combination trial that was both erlotinib, the EGFR inhibitor, to deal with that portion of the disease, as well as cabozantinib, another multi-targeted drug that does inhibit MET, and this patient had a great response to that combination. So the final topic I'm going to cover is HSP90. HSP90 does not hit a particular target, at least a signaling target in the cancer cell, like the EGFR inhibitors or the MET inhibitors. HSP90 is a protein in the cancer cell that acts in a chaperone function to essentially keep other proteins, like EGFR, for example, or ALK, folded and functioning correctly. I explain it to patients as the maintenance man in the factory. You've got a factory of a cancer cell that's going, and there's all these wheels and different assembly line pieces, and the maintenance man goes around and tightens the screws and oils all the gears. And so if you take out that maintenance man with an HSP90 inhibitor, all that stuff will eventually break down. So that's how HSP90 works in broad strokes in the cancer cell. There have been several, at least 3 different compounds that have been studied in lung cancer. The first is IPI-504, also called rituximycin. This is a summary of a clinical trial that was done in patients where we knew the genotype, or we tried to know their genotype. And so all 3 of these diagrams show the same group of patients, but the numbers are different because it's only the patients who are known to be either EGFR mutant or wild type on the upper left. On the upper right, KRAS mutant or wild type, and in the bottom, ALK rearrangement, positive or negative. So essentially, this drug as a single agent did have some activity. There were a couple of patients with EGFR mutations that showed responses, some KRAS patients with some shrinkage, although no responses, and the majority or the biggest group that seemed to hone in on the responses were those with ALK rearrangement. And that was mirrored again with ST-9090 or ganitaspib, similar design, phase two single agent trial, looking at how different molecular genotypes did. And so these are the overall results. You can see that the EGFR mutant patients have red lines. There were a couple with tumor shrinkage, but really nothing in the EGFR mutant group. The KRAS mutants with the yellow lines had some more tumor shrinkage, but in this group, the most dramatic shrinkage was in those that were both wild type for EGFR and KRAS, and further analysis showed that the red lines, the ALK rearranged patients, had some of the biggest benefit to this drug as well. And then the third HSP90 inhibitor that's been studied in lung cancer is AUY922. Again, similar study, single agent drug being looked at in patients, many of whom have a known genotype. The overall response rate for the entire trial was 16%. So at least with these small studies, AUY seems to be the best in class for lung cancer. And in the EGFR mutant patients, 20% response rate to AUY. We have also seen, just anecdotally, some great responses to AUY922 in patients with exon 20 insertion mutations, those mutations that we talked about that were not so sensitive to the TKIs. So we have an ongoing study looking specifically at that drug for that population of patients. Again, with AUY, we've seen dramatic response, relatively dramatic compared to the other HSP90s, responses in ALK patients, 32% in this initial study. And Dr. Shaw may talk about ongoing studies looking at AUY and ALK. As far as stepping back to the broader population, ganitaspib, which is the STA drug, was promising in combination with docetaxel in the second line setting for all lung cancer patients. This is being followed up with a randomized phase three trial, which is currently ongoing. So looking at ongoing HSP90 studies across the spectrum of lung cancer, we've got the main randomized three study is Galaxy 3, looking at ganitaspib and docetaxel versus docetaxel alone. Then there are some smaller studies looking at genotype specific questions. AUY922 is the predominant one. We're also looking at rituximycin with Kris, and there are some others that are not listed here as well, I'm sure. So thank you for your attention, that whirlwind through EGFR, MET, and HSP90.
All right, well, Lecia, thank you very much. That was really interesting. We'll save questions for the panel discussion when we'll discuss some cases and cover a number of questions, and everybody can comment. So we will stop here, and the next segment, Dr. Alice Shaw will talk to us about ALK and ALK inhibitors, ROS1 and RET and some other topics. So come back to us in just a minute. Thanks again.